Your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to penetrate the highly secured archive inside the Kremlin and retrieve Cobalt's file before he can destroy it. New intel suggests Cobalt is already en route, leaving you
4 hours 52 minutes
to infiltrate. To save time, we've chosen your team for you. Agents Carter and Dunn. As always, should you or any member of your team be caught or killed, the Secretary will disavow any knowledge of your actions. This message will self-destruct in 5 seconds. Good luck, Ethan.
Well, good morning. Good morning and welcome to The Journey. I really appreciate everyone of you for coming here today. If you are with us for the first time, as Paul mentioned, thank you for coming, and we want you to know that wherever you're at on your spiritual journey, you're welcome here. Regardless of what you believe, where you've been, what you've done, where you're going, you're welcome here, and we're glad that you're here, and we hope that you have a good time today. And if I haven't met you, please don't leave. I'd love to meet you on your way out today. So, this morning we start a brand new series called The Journey on Mission. And I love that scene from Ghost Protocol that we just watched, not only because in the context of the movie, it's funny, okay, it really is, but also because there's some spiritual truth to that whole scene there. God has given us a near impossible mission in this life. He's picked our team for us. Just look around. Okay, look around. You can turn your heads. Okay, here we go. Yes, yeah, turn your heads. I just like look around your eyes. Okay, yeah, there we go. Turn your heads. It's up to us to understand the mission. It's up to us to accept the mission and to accomplish that mission as well. And the only difference is that unlike the government, God won't abandon us if we mess up. All right, he's not going to just like leave you hanging. Oh, I don't know you and your history. But mission is powerful. It is very powerful. It will instruct you. Mission will direct you. Mission will focus you. It will move you to accomplish great things. A journey without a mission is aimless. Without clear mission, very little gets accomplished. Mission is, you know, for example, to clean house. If you have a mission to clean your house, Oprah gets turned off, right? And the vacuum cleaner comes out. If you don't have a mission to clean your house, then you have a dirty house, right? Even in the movie that we just saw, a movie clip, without the mission, the nuke, I'm going to give you guys the end of the story here, you know, the nuke would have destroyed San Francisco. Oh, and the 49ers were probably playing away on that scene. But anyway, it would have destroyed San Francisco while Ethan Hunt would have just sat around playing Clash of Clans or Candy Saga or whatever it is, right? Candy Crush Saga. I'm not saying that those things are wrong or anything. Just, you know, mission is powerful. It is very, very powerful. And it's necessary if we want our lives to count. Mission is so necessary. Zig Ziglar said this: outstanding people have one thing in common, an absolute sense of mission. A philosopher said this: the man without a purpose is like a ship without a rudder, a waif, a nothing, a no man. John Maxwell said, we feel unhappy or confused with our life when we don't do the focus or calling that God has on our life. And I like this little poem of a missionless man. Okay, it says, there was a very cautious man who never laughed or played. He never risked, he never tried, he never sang or prayed. And when one day he passed away, his insurance was denied, for he never really lived. They claim that he never really died. Okay, kind of funny. But it's true, you know, mission gets us to a place. It gets us to accomplish something in life. And these things are true of individuals like you and me, and these things are true as well in regards to churches, businesses, organizations, corporations. You lose your sense of mission and you lose. That's just how it is. That's how it goes. And so the title of the talk today is Alive with Purpose. And one of the big problems in regards to mission isn't necessarily that people are unwilling to accomplish a mission, you know, though that happens sometimes. But one big problem is that we don't always understand it. We don't understand the mission. Misunderstandings cause all kinds of disasters all the time, right? How many of you have ever misunderstood someone and it didn't end well? Okay, yeah, a lot of us. It happens all the time. It happens in families. It happens in marriages with kids. You know, my son, Michael, who's not here today, last fall, we were setting up Christmas lights and so forth up here on the church, and Tyson was with him, and he's on the roof, right? He's helping set him up. And he wants to jump off the roof. And we're like, no, you're not going to jump off. Why can't I? You're not going to jump off the roof. Why can't I? Dude, you jumped off a big swing and you broke your arm a couple years ago, okay? And so he doesn't jump off the roof. Well, then, of course, a few months later, he's at someone's birthday party over at the Strong's house, and he's jumping off their roof. And we're like, dude, we told you not to jump off the roof. Well, you just said not to jump off the church's roof. Okay, well, don't jump off any roof, okay? Oh, okay, well, I didn't know that, right? And so then, of course, now a couple months later, it's raining cats and dogs outside. We have a big thunderstorm this summer outside, and someone threw his shoe up there, so he climbs up on the roof. And it's raining hard, and you know, I mean, and we're like, dude, we told you not to get on the roof. No, you said don't jump off the roof. I didn't jump off the roof. Anyway, so all kinds of misunderstandings that happen. Some of you heard the story when I spent 2 months in Africa, and their culture is a lot different. And so I'm walking along with my translator, and he, you know, just kind of walking along and kind of talking. And he reached over and starts to grab my hand, to hold my hand. And I'm like, dude, what are you doing? You know? And well, I mean, in that culture, there's nothing wrong with it. It's guys are being friendly. Kind of like, you know, girls here will hold hands and we don't think of anything. And I'm just getting really uncomfortable. I'm from San Francisco. And so I'm thinking, you know, dude, I know there's probably not any malintent here, but I'm not into the cuddle bugging with guys, okay? So, but you know, misunderstandings can really, really hurt and damage things. Anyway, but one big, huge, ancient misunderstanding that has gone on for centuries and it still goes on today has to do with who Jesus really is and what the church is supposed to be about. And so I'm going to show a video clip that I've shown a couple of times before, but it's one of those, you got to see it every year and a half, maybe 2 years or so, okay? Because it's funny. And I hope you don't misunderstand my intent in this, okay? But this is just an illustration of how a lot of people see Jesus or the church, and, you know, and they totally misunderstand who he is and what he's about, and churches by and large are to blame. So relax, enjoy, you can laugh. Okay, here we go. Go ahead and hit it.
Think he can fly?
Shh. Here he comes. Well, all right. Now it's time for me to tell you all what you've done wrong since I last saw you. And don't try and hide, because I'm Jesus. I will find you. Let's start with you, Peter. You lied to your mother the other day. Andrew, you said a naughty word when you hit your finger with the hammer. James, you laughed at him when he hit his finger. Moving right along, John, you drank too much wine the other night. Not way too much, just enough to make me angry. Matthew, we fell asleep in church, didn't we? Yes, we did. And Thomas, you were slow dancing a little too close with that girlfriend of yours. Let's see, and you, I forgot your name, so you're off the hook for now. Philip, I saw you smoking a cigarette behind that big rock the other day. Thaddeus, I hate to say I saw you stick up your middle finger at someone who cut you off when you were riding your camel. Benjamin, you aren't wearing your WWJD bracelet. Jacob, I don't mind you saying my name, but not after you stub your toe. Frank, you know what you did. I just can't repeat it because I'm Jesus. All right, all you sinners, come with me. It's time to pay the piper.
Man, it was only one cigarette.
I heard that. Look at all these sinners. All right, listen up. Listen to me, I'm Jesus. Listen to what I have to say. I have done many wonderful things. I have healed many people of diseases. I have performed many miracles so that I can tell you this. You're all evil. There is no hope. That's it. Thank you.
I know. There are Christians who think I'm in a rotten hell for showing this video clip, right? But you know, it's often Christians like that who portray Jesus like that, right? And the church is something that other than they are, and so people misunderstand who Jesus is and what the church is supposed to be about. You know, this video clip, as funny as it is not the Jesus that the writers of Scripture write about, okay? Not at all. You know, if people think that, they misunderstand. And in the same way, people, both churchgoers and non-churchgoers as well, have for centuries misunderstood the church and what the church is supposed to be about. Now, I know I've kind of set something up already, and so just as best and as honest as you can, what are some of the first things that come to your mind, good or bad, when you hear the word church? Just shout out a couple of them, okay? If you're here for the first time, by the way, and you're not a person who normally associates with churches, or maybe you're not you're a spiritually curious person, you're invited to chime in too, okay? So take some swings. What are some things? What's that? Hypocrisy, yeah.
Community,
okay, good. Cult, yeah, all right. We're not one. You don't have to agree with me on everything. Okay, so anyway, all right, what else?
Righteousness,
yes. Huh? Healing?
Family.
Oh, family, yes. Family, healing, yeah, okay.
Arguing in the car.
Yes, yes. One or two more, real quick.
Teaching,
okay.
Hope.
All right, good. Or did you say Pope? Hope, okay, yeah, all right. But... You know, there's all kinds of things come to mind. A building, right? A thing you go to on Sundays, the longest hour of the week, for some people. An institution for people with overactive consciences. You know, a social club, a place that does weddings and funerals. All these kinds of things. They care for the poor, the hypocrites, the self-righteous, or you know, they're boring, good people, painful, too political, whatever it is. You know, and everything that we've talked about, everything that I've mentioned as well, I've experienced. And at some points in my life, I've been those people. I've been judgmental, and I've been self-righteous, and I've been hypocritical, and I've been self-serving, and I've hurt people, and I've also been hurt by other people, just like we've described. And much of the church we see today, not necessarily the journey, but much of the church that we see today, is not how it began and not quite what Jesus had originally intended. You know, and so this series, we're going to look at the church, and specifically this church, the journey. We're going to try to get rid of some of the churchy misunderstandings and instead identify who we are and why we exist, what's our mission. And you know, similar to our last series in Ephesians that we just finished, you know, just like it says, where Paul spent time saying, this is who you are, and so now because of this is who you are, live a life worthy of the calling you've received. And it's true for individuals, but it's also true for churches, because churches are made up of individuals. And so we'll look at what is a church and why does it exist and who came up with that funny word anyway, right? Church. It's just a weird word, church. It sounds so churchy, and just church. But anyway, my hope is that this series will inspire you to pursue mission, and specifically to jump in and pursue the mission that we here at The Journey have. You know, we're here for a big reason. As Paul mentioned while during the music time, we're growing. Our real God is meeting real people and doing real things in their lives. And so whether you've been church all your life or whether this is the first time you're in church and you consider yourself non-religious, I hope that you'll be inspired to be part of something that Jesus started a long time ago. And by the way, we don't consider ourselves very religious here either. Otherwise, it wouldn't have shown that offensive Jesus video, right? Okay, so there's a green sheet in your handout that you can take notes with if you like. And let's start into it. let's look at the movement that went off track. The church had a magnetically irresistible beginning. Okay? And when I think of irresistible, I think of things that I'm drawn to. Smiles and cuddles with my kids, iced tea on a hot day, a warm fireplace in the winter, fresh powder to ski on when it's ski season, a coffee bean blast ice cream from Trader Joe's is irresistible to me. Tony Romo throwing three picks against the Niners. Yes, that's irresistible. I just love to watch that kind of stuff. Anyway, but the church was like that in the beginning. It was irresistible. It was magnetic. And not just to church people, but to non-church people. Let's look at a passage up on the screen and out of the book of Acts, the New Testament. A deep sense of awe came over them all, and the apostles performed many miraculous signs and wonders. That's pretty cool. Okay. And all the believers met together constantly and shared everything they had. They sold their possessions and shared the proceeds with those in need. They worshiped together at the temple each day, met in homes. They shared meals and with great joy and generosity, all the while praising God and enjoying the goodwill or the favor of all the people. All the people, that includes unchurched people too. And each day the Lord added to their group those who were being saved. Man, what was happening at that time, the first church there was magnetic. It was powerful. They knew who they were. They knew what they were about and where they were going. And God was in their midst. The love and the generosity that people had were real and contagious. And this wasn't socialism, okay? It wasn't like, you know, anything forced on. This was changed hearts and saying, I want to participate with what God's want to do, and I want to share what God's given me, because I know he's always, you know, I mean, there's a difference between that, right? And so, it was a message that they proclaimed. It was irresistibly good news. The new church movement was led by men and women who were fueled, not just by what they believed, but by what they had seen. Okay? And that alone sets a church apart from every other religious system in history. It wasn't the teachings of Jesus that had moved his followers to action. Though, you know, those things helped, okay? But they didn't understand half of what Jesus taught anyway, okay? I mean, you read through, like, okay, wow. It was his resurrection that they saw. The people in the early church weren't simply adhering to the latest ideas or philosophical thoughts or whatever it was. They weren't just following another great leader. They were actually eyewitnesses of an event that you and I just don't see every day, and that's the resurrection of Jesus Christ. And they were moved and empowered by God to take this message of what they had seen and what it had meant for humanity everywhere they went. You know, they're like, we've got to invite others to know this Jesus who rose from the dead, to experience the life that he has given us and called us to live, to be transformed by the matchless love of God. You know, the beginnings were powerful and they were basically irresistible. They were focused. They had a mission. And it was that way for the first few centuries. In the first couple centuries, there were times when in the Roman Empire, plagues would hit and would devastate cities and wipe them out and kill people. The Christians were known to not have fled, but to have stayed with the people who were dying and were willing to die with the people so they would not die alone. And you fast forward to the 1980s when AIDS broke out. And what did the church do? Was the church there for those with AIDS, committed to them, and saying, we're here for you? No, instead the church was pointing fingers and saying, you sinners, judgment has come upon you. And the church abandoned them. What happened? You see the differences between that first church and the church that I experienced growing up and saw that happen firsthand. And so to answer that, we're going to spend the next few minutes a little bit of history, okay? So I hope you're okay with that and that you're a little bit more like my wife than you are like me. She loves history. She soaks it up. I fall asleep. But anyway, so try not to fall asleep, okay? Because Jesus will notice. Anyway, just kidding. Okay, so next point here is the existence of the church is not normal, okay? It's not natural, actually. When I say not natural, I'm not talking about things like Chicken McNuggets or a Twinkie, okay? There's nothing natural about those. I'm not talking about a hairpiece or a spray on tan, okay? You can kind of tell sometimes, but that's not natural, right? I'm talking more like supernatural, okay? I'm talking more like miracle, maybe. And when you look at history, the birth, the survival, the growth of the church. It is absolutely amazing. It is really inexplainable. The reason is that there is no natural explanation for why the church survived the first century. None whatsoever, let alone 20 centuries. Okay, think about it. It started with a small group of Jewish nonconformists who defied the political powers that were there, the Roman government, and the religious system that had been there for 1,000 years. And in the end, won. Okay? Think about it. It started with a small, it was a movement. It was a movement that was as grassroots as you can get, originally referred to as the Way. It started with a Jewish carpenter who spoke mostly in parables that a lot of people didn't quite understand. He taught that people should actually love their enemies. He taught that people should pay their taxes. What? Right? He seemed to favor the poor over the rich. That's not a way to fund your ministry, okay? Or your movement. He offended almost everybody, including those closest to him. His family thought that he had lost his mind. Religious leaders hated him. After only 3 years of public ministry, he was arrested, humiliated, and executed. Not quite the qualifications you'd pick for your book on how to be successful and have a lot of friends, right? It's just not. And it gets even stranger. Look at the followers that Jesus picked. Not the ripest mangoes in the bunch, okay? They just weren't. Picture Jesus. He's walking along. He's talking to God. And all right, God says, okay, it's time to pick, your disciples. All right, and God says, okay, those two over there. Points to Peter and Andrew. And Jesus, knowing who they are. Are you serious, God? You're right? I thought you wanted this to succeed. You could just picture that happening. And after Jesus' execution, these stressed out, fearful, discouraged, not so bright followers claimed that Jesus rose from the dead and that they had seen him, touched him, spoke to him, and ate with him. And within weeks, dozens and dozens and then hundreds of people within walking distance of where Jesus had been buried started claiming the same thing and telling other people about it. And within about a month and a half, the number grew to over 3,000 people. And in spite of the same resistance that crucified Jesus and in spite of ensuing executions for following Christ, much like happening in the Middle East right now, this church continued to grow way beyond Jerusalem and on into the Roman world and Roman Empire. And not only did it survive the first century, but also the next 2 centuries after that, where intense Roman persecution had broken out simply because these followers claimed that Jesus was their king and not the emperor of Rome. And there was also, of course, a spiritual enemy at work, as we looked at last week. But after 3 centuries, this Jewish knockoff religion, now called the Way, now called Christians, which should have been squelched, became the primary belief system of the Roman Empire that tried to wipe it out in the first place. And the church then survived the next 1,200 years in spite of incredible religious corruption that happened as a result. And so today, over a third of the world's entire population claims some kind of faith in Jesus Christ. Rome is long gone. Ancient Judaism died in the first century. But today, over 2 billion people claim Jesus as the centerpiece of their faith. Jesus taught for 3 years and is now worshipped on every continent on this planet. Doesn't quite add up, does it? Like, wow, that's a miracle. Okay, so let's take a look at the very first time the church was ever mentioned. The next point is the church was founded on the identity of Jesus Christ. And if I'm talking fast, it's because it's getting late. And anyway, so here we go. So one day, during a time when Jesus was doing great things and gaining popularity, he asked his disciples, he said, "Who do people say that I am?" And his disciples fired back various, responses that they had heard, everything from a good teacher to some people think that you're the prophet Elijah come back from the dead. Kind of a spooky. I wonder if Jesus said that. Anyway, but then Jesus asked him, "Well, what about you? Who do you say that I am?" And immediately Simon Peter says, "You are the Christ, the Son of the living God." And up on the screen, we're going to look at Jesus' response. He said, "You are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. Now I say to you that you are Peter, and upon this rock I will build my church, and the powers of hell will not conquer it." Okay? And this is the first time church shows up in our English New Testament. Jesus predicted that he would build it and that nothing, even hell, would defeat it, would stand in its way. And it's amazing to think that today, that every time we meet, we're a modern day fulfillment of what Jesus said 2,000 years ago. Okay? It's like, wow, how did he know? That's pretty cool. But when Jesus made that statement, on this rock I will build my church, he was saying that the foundation of this new thing called the church was a revelation given to Peter about who Jesus is, the Christ, the Son of the Living God. So the foundation is Jesus and who he is. And this is why churches are always talking about Jesus. The identity of Jesus as the Savior, the Son of God, is the foundation of the church and is really one of the few things that unites churches globally. Now enter the misunderstanding. Most people, when speaking in conversation, refer to church as a place. Okay? Somewhere to go on Sundays. Do you go to church? Yes, I go to church. I'm going to church tomorrow. Really, where do you go to church? Okay, and it's all about going, going, going. Or it's a building. Or, you know, what is your church like? Is it the green one? Is it the brick one? Is it the ugly one? Okay, you're right. Is it a big one, small one? Does your church have a youth room or a bathroom? I mean, you know, and we think about buildings. And this is what most people in our culture think about or talk about when it comes to church. Then they might go on and talk about singing songs that don't make sense, or, you know, or some guy in a suit that's, you know, yelling at them because they're sinners. But when the identity and the nature or purpose or mission of the church gets misunderstood, then things get off track. Things just go where they're not supposed to go. And that's especially true for those, you know, who go to church, right? Okay, rather are the church. Look at this next point. The church is not a building. It's a gathering of people with a specific mission, or for a specific mission. In that same statement, when Jesus first mentions church, and so there's a few people here, you know this, you've heard this, you've understood this, but most don't, okay? When Jesus first mentions church, Jesus used an interesting word in the Greek, which is the original language spoken at the time. Jesus spoke Greek. Most people don't know this. The word ekklesia. It'll be on the screen there, okay? And I think it's actually pronounced ecclesia or something like that, but I don't like that pronunciation, so I'm going to use my gringo form, ecclesia, okay? It's an assembly of people who are called out for a specific purpose, usually to extend influence or even to rule, okay? It was a word that was used to describe Greek or Roman citizens who were called out to help govern a city or a district or to make a decision or whatever it was. Ecclesia never referred to a specific place or building. It referred to a gathering of people united by a common identity or purpose. And there are a number of reasons I mention this. One is it's technical and might be a little bit nerdy, but it's important. Speaking of something misunderstood, ecclesia doesn't even translate into our English language as church. It translates as gathering. Okay, so then like, why does our Bible, why do our Bible say church in it? Okay, I'm so glad you asked. All right, so, This is part of the reason that this irresistible movement kind of stopped moving and became an establishment and stopped being so irresistible. Back in the 4th century, a little bit of history here, when Constantine became the emperor of Rome, he put his faith in Christ, converted Christianity, and then he declared freedom of religion within the entire Roman Empire. But then he did one more thing, is he also, within the next 10 years, he also made Christianity the national religion, okay? And he thought he was doing a favor to everybody, and it wasn't necessarily a favor, okay? But within about 10 years, this grassroots movement called the church was then organized and institutionalized, and then bad things started to happen, all right? Not saying that organization and institutions are bad things, it's just that things happened along the way when that Roman government got involved, okay? And so, for example, one of the common practices at the time was to commemorate the anniversary of a martyr's death. This was the grassroots church, okay? Early Christians would worship and share communion near or at this person, this martyr's grave. And so the Roman elite took that to a whole new level, and they started building buildings and cathedrals at these martyrs', you know, graves and so forth. And so in a short amount of time, ecclesia ceased to become an expanding movement of people that shared a unique mission and identity. It had become a location. And the Roman word for that was basilica. Okay? And then, you fast forward several hundred years now, German cultures then use the word Kirika, or, which became Kirche in the modern German. Okay? And this meant house of the Lord, and was used to refer to any religious gathering place. And it's that Germanic term that became one of the most often referred to as the Ecclesia of Jesus. And from this word, Kirche, we get church. Okay, you following on that? And so whereas most of our English New Testament is accurately translated word for word or idea for idea from the Greek text, this word church isn't. It's not even a translation. It's just, it's a bad substitution is what it is. Because ecclesia and kirche refer to two different things. You following that? Okay, and that's kind of in a nutshell, in the last, you know, 4.5 minutes, the history of about 1,800 years of church, okay? But words have meaning. And so church became synonymous with a location rather than a movement of people with a mission. In the Middle Ages, whoever controlled the church building now controlled the church. And whoever controlled the church controlled the scriptures and the people. And so for the next 1,000 to 1,200 years, corrupt and evil people distorted and turned something that began as an irresistible, beautiful movement into an ugly, power-grabbing, hierarchical, ritualized institution that committed vile acts of terrorism in the name of its founder, Jesus Christ. And that's where we get a lot of the, you know, the Crusades and Inquisition and all of that. And while it's incredible that the church survived the first century or two, it's even more incredible that it survived the next 1,200 years of the corruption that followed. But it did survive, just as Jesus promised. And I wish I had time to talk about the reformers of the 16th century who finally took a stand against the powers that were and came against it and said, no, this is not what the Bible says. This is not what Jesus called us to. And they went and they took the scriptures and they started translating. When after the printing press was made, they translated into the modern languages and started trying to distribute to get in the hands of everyday people. And when they did that, the church started killing them. Arresting them and killing them because they did not want them to do. They wanted control. And so anyway, long story short, the church, through some simple misunderstandings, is still trying to find its identity and purpose today. And it's still confusing kirche with ecclesia and its mission and its reason for existence and so forth. Now I want to make a side note here. You know, some Christians, they swing the pendulum and they say, see, we don't need any buildings. We shouldn't have any buildings. We didn't spend any money. Well, we've got something called weather, okay? And people need a place to gather. And, you know, well, we can do that at homes. Well, okay, yeah. And that's where a lot of churches start, is in homes. But a healthy church grows. Just like you want your healthy child to grow, a healthy church grows. And so then you outgrow. And so, yeah, we do, you know, and it's nice to have a roof over your head when, you know, it's too hot outside or it's too cold outside. And it's nice to have air conditioning and Wi-Fi. Anyway, let's move on. So what do we need to do? How can you and I get me more involved in Jesus' original idea? Let's look at getting on track and building momentum. And boy, I've got to build momentum with how fast I'm talking because, all right, so first of all, understand the mission. We have to understand what ecclesia is about, what Jesus came to start and why. Not just understand up here, but to let it come down into here and to connect with it in our hearts here. Why? So that then it goes out through here and comes out through our mouths. Does that make sense? It's got to do that. And ever since the beginning of life on this planet, you know, humankind has been guilty of something called sin. You know, we started off in a perfect relationship with God, the creator, the lover of our souls. But then something happened and we started going our own way, far from God. And that sin that we're all guilty of, the sins that hurt people, the sins that ruin life, worse than the ugliest of diseases that are everywhere in this world and in our hearts, these sins have separated us from God. And not only have those sins separated us from God, but they have destroyed and even ruled our lives as well, or parts of our lives as well. And Jesus came to restore what has been destroyed and has called his church, this ecclesia, to join him in that mission, which is so much more than just going to church, right? When you think about restoring what has been lost, it's so much more than coming to church and just kind of sitting, listening to me yabber on off, right? But, well, Mike, do you really believe this? Yes, I do. It's why I've committed my life to it. I totally believe it. See, when I see God restore lives, for example, knowing what some of you have gone through and watching Jesus put broken pieces back together, or like some who were baptized a few weeks ago, some of the youth were baptized a few weeks ago as well, you know, knowing what they face, watching them come to a real living relationship with Jesus, seeing hope rise in people and a lot of you here, it not only excites me, it reminds me of why I do this. And this is what we're about. It's mission. And so ecclesia, a gathering of people that are called for a purpose, and one of which is to extend influence or rule. Okay? Not rule in a government sort of way. Participating in ecclesia is multifaceted. First, it's a movement of people who are no longer subject to the rule of sin and the powers of darkness, as we looked at last week. Okay? They've been set free by the power of Jesus Christ and have been brought into the kingdom of God. There's restored relationship with God. There's a new way of living. And with that, we, the ecclesia of Jesus, have been given a mission to gather and extend God's rule and influence into the lives of others. Jesus talked a lot about this thing called the kingdom of God. And where there's a kingdom, there is a king, right? And where there's a king, there's influence and there's authority and there's rule. And there's someone who's in charge. And we know that in heaven, for example, where God rules, life is perfect there. And it's magnetic and it's irresistible and things work. It's the way he always intended. And when the church extends the kingdom of God here, we extend the rule of God into to people. But it's not by force or coercion or threats or guilt or manipulation. It's by an irresistible message of the love of God and the good news of hope and grace and an invitation that comes from God himself. He says, come join me. Come join me. Man, I'm not all angry at you. I love you. Come and join me and be part of this. You know, and so as we lovingly yield our hearts to him, he begins to reign in our hearts. And as that happens, he also restores and heals and transforms and brings peace and joy and makes us alive. And as the result, the powers of sin and that rule in our hearts and the powers of darkness that rule our lives, they start losing their grip and start losing their influence within us. And we're invited to that mission, to influence and invite people to God through Jesus Christ, breaking people free from the grip of hell in their lives and exposing them to the God whose rule sets us free and gives us life. And we see real miracles happen. And that same magnetic irresistibility that the first church experienced begins to take place. Not only do we get to have a taste of heaven, but we also get to be a part of populating heaven as people connect with Jesus and trust in him for the very first time. Now here's one of the things that happens by default when people misunderstand ecclesia and misunderstand the mission. Okay, I'm going to show the next slide here. You see all of those arrows pointing inward there? We get ingrown when we misunderstand what ecclesia is about. We get ingrown. We get self-centered. We get focused on ourselves. How we like things and how we think church should be and how we think people should treat us and who we think should be part of the church. And it becomes junior high all over again. Okay, with all the drama and everything. It just does. No offense to junior hires, but you guys know what I'm talking about, okay? I was in junior high once, and I hated junior high. But anyway, you know, anytime an organization or anytime an organism even starts to get inward and self-focused and loses sight of it, if its mission, sickness sets in. And we get off track and begin traveling the road of slow death. But when we realize our purpose, our mission begins with those who aren't yet here, and our concern is intentionally placed on other people rather than just self. Okay, next slide. Life begins to happen. That's how we are supposed to be facing and looking and what we're supposed to be doing. Life begins to happen. And growth happens, just like in that first church. And so let me just give you a picture of what the journey is about, why we exist, who we're here for, where we want to go, what we must do, you know, and if we want to see Jesus really begin to start making things happen. First of all, with our concern for others that are not here, okay, those in the community in which we live, those outside around us, okay, who are far from God maybe, for example, we have to invite them to find Jesus. Next slide. We have to. There's the community right there. Invite people to find Jesus. Okay? Just as the first church was active in getting the message out, same with us. Scripture says this on the next slide. But how can they call on him to save them unless they believe in him? And how can they believe in him if they have not heard about him? And how can they hear about him unless someone tells them? Unless someone tells them. And so we invite people to find him, to know him, the greatest decision of their life. But once someone finds Christ and comes to faith, our mission isn't over. Okay? Not by a long shot. Next slide. We have to inspire people to grow in faith. Okay? And notice that all these are starting with the letter I. All right? This is kind of cute. But anyway, it kind of helps with memory. But just like many of us here, you've placed your faith in Christ. But it's my hope and God's desire that you won't stay with a young faith, but that we can inspire you to grow in your faith and your faith relationship with Christ. Nobody can be forced to grow in their faith. Okay, nobody wants to be forced. You know, if I'm forced to do something, I get flashbacks of parochial school and mean nuns with big sticks, okay? But you don't grow that way. But we hope to inspire people because growing in faith is attractive and good. Okay, but we don't stop there. We also want to, next slide, interact with others so we can become more like Jesus. And there's a difference between growing in faith and transforming in character and in action. And this is where we see cool things happen. Those with no hope become hopeful. Those who are hurting become healed and start helping others. The weak become strong. The faithless become faithful. The angry become kind and forgiving. The fearful become peaceful. The addicted get free. Takers become givers. The same things that happen to Jesus' followers begin to happen to us. And when this starts happening, our mission is still not quite complete. One more thing still has to happen. Listen to what Jesus said when he called Peter and Andrew. Okay, on the screen. He said, that's not the right one. Okay, I'll read it to you. He said this, come follow me, Jesus said, and I will make you fishers of men. Follow Jesus and something else happens. He takes us beyond our self-made life and back into the community in which he found us. And he says, now go find others. Okay, so here, next slide. We become influencers and we influence people so that we can reach the community and help others find Jesus. You see how that goes? Okay, that's what we are about. And every single one of us is somewhere here on this picture. Okay, you may be here and you know about Christ, but you haven't found that personal relationship with him and that personal faith with him yet. You may have found him and now you're growing your faith, or maybe you need to. Or maybe your next step is to interact with others and so become more like Christ. Maybe you're an influencer or you're scared to death of it, and that's your next step. And you're still growing in faith and still transforming, but man, you're beginning to influence. We're all somewhere in here on that. And so, we see our mission of the journey, but how? Okay? Well, we invite people to find Jesus. Okay? One way is Sunday services there in the red. Okay? That's one way. Invite to outreaches when we have outreaches. You can personally lead someone to Christ, but Sunday services make things a little bit easier. Okay, a lot of people are scared to death to share their faith and talk about Jesus, but inviting people to church, you can do that. Okay, we inspire people to grow, next slide, through devotions and discipleship. Okay, we'll talk about that coming up, not today. And then we interact with others through small groups and through serving. Okay, he who walks with the wise becomes wise. Companion of fools suffers harm. Jesus came to serve. And the last, we learn to become influential people and develop influential relationships. Okay? But like Ethan Hunt, we've got to understand the mission. And like the disciples, next point, we're almost done here, we've got to experience the resurrected one. See, the Christ followers, the first Christ followers, had that advantage in a lot of ways. They saw the resurrected Jesus. They touched him. They spoke to him. They heard him. They heard him speak. They experienced him. They ate with him. Though it's not the same sense for us in the physical dynamic, we can and we need to experience the risen Christ in our lives today. And if you're a Christ follower, you need to experience him. To know him, to hear his voice, as Mike was talking about, learning to hear his voice. To walk closely with him, to be filled with and empowered by his Spirit. It's not just about moving forward with a belief. It's about moving forward because we have experienced Jesus Christ. Just like the first followers of Christ had seen him. Okay? And now we want to tell people what we have seen and heard. And this is why our music time, our worship time is so important. It's why prayer is so important. It's why reading our Bibles is important. It's why gathering together is important. We need to experience a resurrected one on whom the identity of Ecclesia is built. And so if you're a churched person, or if you're an unchurched person, call out to him. Say, I want to know you. I want to know you. And I want to see when I experience you. And last, just like Ethan Hunt and like the first church, choose to accept the mission. Okay? Your mission, should you choose to accept it. All right? And come alive with purpose. Be part of something that's so much bigger than yourself. Part of something that will save lives, that will change lives, that will save souls. Let's stand and we're going to pray. And as we stand, you know, I invite you to be part of this with us. Let Jesus do things in you and through you that you never imagined that he would do in or through you. That you never imagined your life becoming. Be part of making this place magnetic and irresistible. You know, drawing people so they can come to faith in Christ. Some of those who were baptized a few weeks ago have found Christ here through the journey because they were drawn to something good. Because and they're still here because it's hard to stay away. They found something that's magnetic. And I like that. And it's the same for many of you. That's why you're here today. It's exciting. So let's grow this. Let's continue to move forward and say, Jesus, I want to be part of what you have started 2,000 years ago. Accept the mission. Okay? And let's invite people to come to Jesus. Let's pray. Let's bow our heads. And let's just close our eyes. Just quickly, if you're a person here and you saw that chart, you saw that graph, and maybe you have heard about Christ, but you have not found Jesus, that relationship with Jesus, you have not put your faith in him for the first time yet, I invite you to do that. And all you need to do is just say, Jesus, I believe in you, and I want you to come into my life and forgive me my sins. And just pray that to him even right now. And let it be real, though. And invite him to forgive you. Ask him to forgive you and to be the leader of your life. You know, if you're praying that for the first time, you know, with no one looking around, would you lift your hand and just let me know that that's something you've done? I mean, you're responding to God speaking to you. I'm not going to embarrass you. If you'd like to tell me later, you can. But God, I just thank you for this day. I thank you for every person that's here in this place. And God, I pray that you would help us to understand the mission, to not be lazy about it, but understand it, to understand what the church is about, and that it's not a building, it's not a place, it's a gathering of people, and that we are part of it. And Lord God, help us to find our place in that, that we may accomplish, Jesus, what you would want us to accomplish and see great things happen. Even just like with Ethan Hunt in that dumb movie, experienced so many things because he accepted the mission. God, help us to accept the mission and to run forward with it. So thank you, God, for every person that's here today. I pray, God, that you would help us to go out and to invite people. And God, as we do, that your Spirit, knowing that your Spirit's at work, drawing people to yourself, may we see your original intentions happen here and through here. In Jesus' name, amen.